Our second scripture reading this morning can be found on page 3 in the New Testament. You don't have to go far. We're reading from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 4, verses 1 through 11. Hear the word of the Lord. Then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. After fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. The tempter came to him and said, "If you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread." Jesus answered, "It is written, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. "If you are the Son of God," he said, "throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and they will lift you up in their hands, and you will not strike your foot against a stone." Jesus answered him, "It is also written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." Again, the devil took him up to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. "All this I will give to you," he said, "if you will bow down and worship me." Jesus said to him, "Away from me, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only." Then the devil left him. And the angels came and attended him. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. There was a woman I worked with many years ago named Priscilla. She loved to sing. She was tone deaf. But there was great joy in that. But she had a way with words. And she used to say that if opportunity came disguised as temptation, one knock would be enough. Unfortunately, it seems that it is far more common for temptation to come disguised as opportunity than the other way around. Something seems too good to be true, but we want so much to believe it that we convince ourselves that this time it might just be possible. Maybe our luck has changed or the planets have lined up to turn out that it's our turn to come out on top, or things are actually going to go our way, or we're being rewarded for something, or maybe this time karma is finally kicking in. We're so good at finding excuses to give in to temptation when it comes disguised as opportunity. It's not unlike a wolf dressed in sheep's clothing, danger lurking in the disguise of innocence. Fortunately for us, Jesus recognized wolves and sheep for what they are and did not confuse temptation with opportunity, not even when it came knocking three times. In terms of chronology of today's scripture, it comes right on the heels of Jesus' baptism. All three of the synoptic gospels place the temptation in the desert story right after the baptism of the Lord. Mark's version goes so far as to use the word euthys, which translates as immediately or instantly. And he says, instantly the Spirit drove him into the wilderness, and he was there in the wilderness for 40 days, being tempted by Satan. Luke's gospel gives the kind of fullest account. Luke liked words. He explains to the mostly Gentile audience what the Jewish people Matthew wrote for would have known. But Matthew's gospel tells us of three temptations and the responses given by Jesus. The period of time that Jesus spent in the wilderness, 40 days, is noteworthy, but not as significant as some might have us believe. In the study of biblical numerology, 40 is actually a very interesting number. One of the more common claims about the meaning of 40 is that it symbolizes a period of probation or trial. Evidence cited usually includes the 40 years that the Hebrews wandered in the desert and the 40 nights and days of the floods and the temptation of Jesus. While the numerology bits can be very interesting and are well worth studying, it's important not to get bogged down in them. They aren't some kind of secret code that we need to decipher. Scripture is meant to be read in its plain meaning. That's what the Reformers decided long ago and has been one of the hallmarks of the Presbyterian Church for as long as the Presbyterian Church has existed. And as my Hebrew professor, Dr. Durlesser, he wrote a book on numerology, taught us, 40 days or 40 years basically means a really long time. 40 days is longer than a moon cycle, longer than a month, a long period of time. 40 years is the equivalent of a couple of generations, a very long time. So the 40 is important, but it's more an indicator of Jesus having to endure a long period of testing. And where did Jesus endure this testing? In the wilderness. We often see the Greek word used there translated as desert, but it more literally means wilderness. Now, why does that matter? What do you think of when you think of a desert? Most of us tend to think of big sand dunes and camels and palm trees with the occasional oasis. Well, a desert can be all of that, certainly. But the word desert is actually a scientific term which refers to any area in which the average rainfall is less than 10 inches per year, or where more water is lost by evapotranspiration than falls as precipitation. Aren't you glad you know that? Thus, not all deserts have the look that we tend to associate with them. Any of you ever been to Maine? Do you know that there's a desert in Maine? There's a desert in Freeport, Maine. You can take a tour. They'll take you out on a bus. Maine's not exactly what we think of as desert. So a desert is simply a place that's dry enough that vegetation and animals are somewhat scarce. A place that's not comfortable and welcoming, but rather barren and inhospitable. Whether the area Jesus went into was sandy or rocky, which is more likely around the area he'd been in, the point is it wasn't inviting, and he had to be there for a long time. And while Jesus was in this barren, uncomfortable place for a long time, the devil or Satan or the evil one, or however you understand the word diabolo, was offering him the very things that would be lacking in such a place, the things a person would miss. He began by offering normal daily sustenance. And we know Jesus was hungry. Matthew's gospel tells us Jesus was hungry. However, we also know from the history of God's people that God doesn't leave them to starve. They may be eating manna for months, or nothing but quail on end for days, and if they're John, they might be eating locusts and wild honey, which does not sound delicious. But God provides. Even if it takes miracles who produce a meal out of nowhere by angels, God provides, not necessarily lavishly, but God provides. So Jesus was hungry. He's been fasting, which was a common religious practice, but what a lot of people don't realize is that among the Jewish people, fasting ends at sundown. So there would have been something at some point, but not on a regular basis, not during the day, not during the time that we expend the most energy. And what there was to eat was not likely the comfort food of home. So Satan says to Jesus, if you are the Son of God, just turn the stones into bread. You can do it. And Jesus knew that the point of wilderness time wasn't about physical food, but about feeding his soul. So instead of giving in to temptation and creating a comfortable little oasis for himself, he withstood what any human would have withstood without using divine powers for his own personal comfort and gain. The response Jesus gives to Satan clearly demonstrates the folly of Satan's suggestion. Man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. Jesus was quoting Deuteronomy and the giving of manna to the Hebrews wandering in the desert. Jesus is pointing out not only the folly of feeding the body and not the soul, but is also highlighting God's divine providence. The second thing that Satan suggests is that Jesus throw himself off the highest point of the temple. And remember, the temple is up on the Temple Mount. That's really the tallest thing that is man-made that's around. And Satan even quotes scripture at Jesus, much like the Pharisees would do later. Satan quotes Psalm 91, which says God's angels will keep the believer from even striking a foot against a stone. That's like saying God will send angels to protect the faithful from even something so small as stubbing their toe. Satan is picking that quote out of context, though, And he's trying to get Jesus to use it as a way to test God instead of understanding the larger psalm and the song of trust and reverence that Psalm 91 is. Even within that psalm of praise and trust in verse 15, it is clear that God does not keep us from all trouble, but is with us through all trouble. Jesus responds in a way that he shows he truly understands the words that Satan tries to twist. This also comes from Deuteronomy. It's part of verse 16, but that verse is in a section that points out we are supposed to live lives of gratitude, not be constantly asking for more and more. And here's what a slightly larger piece of Deuteronomy says. When the Lord your God brings you into the land he swore to your fathers, to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob to give you, a land with large, flourishing cities that you didn't build, houses filled with all kinds of things you didn't provide, wells you didn't dig, and vineyards and olive groves you didn't plant. Then when you eat and are satisfied, be careful that you do not forget the Lord who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. Fear the Lord your God and serve him only and take your oaths in his name. Do not follow other gods, the gods of the peoples around you. For the Lord your God, who is among you, is a jealous God, and his anger will burn against you, and he will destroy you from the face of the land. Do not put the Lord your God to the test, as you did at Massah. Be sure to keep the commands of the Lord your God and the stipulations and decrees he has given you. Do what is right and good in the Lord's sight, so that it may go well with you, and you may go in and take over the good land the Lord promised on oath to your ancestors, thrusting all your enemies out before you, as the Lord said. So we see from these words that God will continue to bless those who acknowledge the blessings already received, and also that Jesus is exactly right. We are not to test God, but to trust God. And when we trust God, God will thrust out our enemies. That theme of trusting in God's divine providence continues in Jesus' second response to Satan, as it was in the first, and even foreshadows the coming victory of our Lord. Satan's third attempt to tempt Jesus is another earthly focus: power. Satan offers Jesus all the kingdoms of the world and all their splendor, saying he will give them to Jesus if Jesus will but bow down and worship him. And Jesus says, "Away from me, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only." And Jesus is quoting from Deuteronomy, the section that is part of the expansion of the great Shema, the ancient words that Moses spoke, saying, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart and all of your soul and all of your strength." Jesus is staying focused on what is truly important, following the Lord's commandment and loving the Lord with his whole self. Jesus doesn't bother trying to logic Satan out of this last reported temptation. Jesus could just as easily have replied, "You know, none of those things you're offering me really belong to you to offer." But Jesus doesn't focus on worldly logic any more than he has focused on worldly needs or desires. Jesus focuses on what's real and what's important, on loving and trusting and worshiping only the one true God. And with that, Satan is defeated, as was promised in the very scriptures Jesus quoted. And that's kind of the point. Yes, Jesus had divine powers that we do not have, but during this time of temptation, Jesus didn't use those divine powers to create comfort or power for himself. He didn't test God to see if God was keeping his word. Instead, Jesus faced all these temptations as fully human, living through them with the same discomfort that we might have if we were in the wilderness alone for a long period of time. But Jesus remained focused not on himself, but on trusting the Lord. And because of this, Satan was defeated. Jesus defeated Satan's efforts to tempt him not by using some divine power, but by simple human trust in the Heavenly Father, who has and is and will continue to be a keeper of promises. This story can seem kind of daunting when we read it on its surface, can be seen also, though, as the greatest of encouragement. See, too often, we read the story of Jesus' temptation as something that we could never withstand, as something that makes us feel like we are so much less faithful than we'd like to be. But the story can build us up if we realize that we have at our disposal everything Jesus had and more, because we also have his eternal and perfect forgiveness. All the passages Jesus quotes are not about the Messiah or the powers of God's chosen and anointed leaders. Each passage Jesus quotes when faced with temptation is about regular, everyday, ordinary folks and God's care of God's people. They all point to the ability of the average believer to withstand the temptations of Satan by trusting in and wholeheartedly loving the Lord. It's not a depressing tale of deprivation. It's not a great battle of wits. And it's not the triumph of divine powers over the powers of hell. It's a story of how all of us are able to resist a bit of temptation if we focus on what is real and true and important, if we will love and trust the Lord and believe with our lives as well as our lips that God truly is in control.